Parallax occlusion mapping is a technique used for many 3D applications, such as video games for example. They essentially allow you to create some depth using just a single face. You can see today we're going to be doing an introduction to parallax mapping. We'll be making this simple moving painting with a tree and a sky. And you'll notice that if I rotate, there's nothing underneath here, and this is just a texture with a little bit of depth. But you can create more complex things, even mimicking cool things such as displacement for example. This tutorial will be a great way to introduce you to the basic concepts we'll be using for more advanced things, so you can get yourself started on the right foot, as this can be quite a confusing topic. To start off, I'm just going to add a plane. So I'll press Shift A, and then under Mesh, I'm going to left click Plane. You also notice I'm in my texture preview mode here, which is this third one here. I'm also going to left click and drag to bring up my timeline. I'm going to change it from the clock to the shader edit. Then you can just press plus new to add a new material. If you're less familiar with adding textures and materials in Blender, it's the same as coming to this red and black checker ball and adding a material here. You notice how these two menus are actually linked. I'm just going to call my material.004 parallax. First of all, we'll need some textures. To download the textures, just go to the link in the description so you can follow along. The tree is from CG Bootcase, but I've edited it just to make sure it's a nice transparent square image. And the sky is from Adobe, but it's one of their free assets. And I just cropped it to square shape, since for this tutorial, having square shaped textures will make this process a little bit more straightforward. Once you've downloaded them, I'm gonna press Shift A, and then under texture, I'm gonna choose image texture. Then you can go ahead and just press open. And I'm just gonna come to my downloads here, and I'm just gonna choose this sky that I've downloaded. And I'll just press open image. If I plug my color into base color here, you can see we've got a nice sky. To go to top view, I'm just going to press this blue Z here. Then I'm going to press Shift A, and then under input, I'm going to use texture coordinate. So if this box here is our image texture or our sky, this texture coordinate is going to tell our texture how to be placed on our face or our object, which in this case is just a simple plane. To start off, we're just going to use UV, which is actually the same as the default, so we'll notice no immediate change. Although later, we will change it, as we'll find that this isn't the optimal way for today's lesson. Then we're going to need to add a vector map. So I'm going to press Shift A, then under converter, we're going to choose vector map. You can also just search for any of these nodes if that's easier for you. I'll just plug that in between here. And right now, since we haven't added anything to our vector and it's still at zero, nothing here is going to change. Now, we need a node which is going to change the texture depending on where we're looking at it. And there is a handy node we can use for that called the geometry node. So I'm going to press Shift A, and I'm going to come to input again. And this time, I'm going to choose geometry. Again, you can just search for any of these nodes. Then we're going to go for this incoming socket here. These purple sockets just mean that it's a vector output. Just like how this purple node here is a vector-based node. I'm going to plug my incoming into the second vector slot. Now you'll notice when I rotate around, the texture moves with it. There's a few problems to address here, but first let's try to figure out what's actually happening. The first thing is that our texture is actually being kind of pushed up right now, and that's because we have this set to add. So I'm going to go ahead and just change this to subtract for now. Now you can see the texture looks like it's underneath our plane, which is kind of what we're wanting. Although we will need to scale up our texture because right now it's a little bit too small, and it's just going to transition harshly to a repeat of the same texture. This would work fine if we were using a repeating texture or a seamless texture, but this is not one of those, so we'll need to do something else to try to get this working. Although you might be wondering what exactly a vector is, since we're actually working with vector math a lot of the time when doing parallax occlusion mapping. I do have a more in-depth video on vectors, which I'd highly recommend you check out. But to give you a quick summary, essentially, a vector represents a direction in Blender. For example, if you know what a normal is, it's essentially the direction of the face, or the vector of the face. And also how a normal map, for example, edits the direction each pixel of an object using a texture. And what this UV here does is it's literally using our UV map. And if you know a little bit about texturing in 3D, that's pretty much used to transition a 2D texture onto a 3D object through a process called UV unwrapping. Right now, we've got our default UV, so that's why this is working okay. Our incoming here is a vector or direction based on where we're looking. That's why when we move around our scene, the texture moves with it based on that direction we're looking. But it's not actually coming from us, it's actually coming from the object itself. This makes sense since this box here or node is attached to this object, not our viewing position. So what that means pretty much is that this incoming vector is coming out from our plane here, and it creates a vector or direction towards where we're looking, creating this effect as we move since it's constantly updating. If that confused you, don't worry, as this is quite an advanced topic. Again, I'd highly recommend you check out my video on vectors to learn a little bit more about vectors in general, and that might make understanding this video a little bit easier. Next up, we're going to do something a little bit more simple to understand. We're going to press Shift A, and in vector, I'm going to left click the map. I'll plug that in between our subtracts and our texture. This node looks scary, but it's actually pretty simple. It allows us to edit the coordinates using simple scale, rotation, and location parameters. For example, if I left click and quickly drag down, all that does is allows me to edit all these numbers at once, and I change the scale, you can see I can zoom into my texture here, and you can see this is how we can start to go about removing this hard border here. If I was to edit just the Y, for example, you'll notice how the texture stretches on just that one axis. I'll change it back to 5 to match the others. Rotation, we'll just rotate it like this. We're not going to use that today, so I'll set that back to 0. And location allows you to edit the location. Pretty straightforward stuff. I'll set that back to 0. I'm going to make this much smaller though. I'm going to change the scale by left clicking, quickly dragging down to select all of them, and typing in 0.2. That's going to make it much smaller. I'm also going to move it a little bit on my X and Y, as right now you can see we can still see our border. So I'm going to change the X and Y to just 0.2. There, now we've moved it a little bit on the X and Y, you can see that's kind of solved the problem. And no matter where we look, we can't quite see the border, which is perfect. Of course, if you don't like this position, you can tweak around this location around to get to something you like. For now though, let's go ahead and add our tree. So I'm going to left click and box select all of these nodes. And I'm actually going to press Shift D to duplicate. This is going to be used for our tree. I'm going to left click and box select these nodes again, and I'm just going to press G to pull them down a little bit. Then I'll press Control J, and that's going to put them in a little box to keep them nice and organized. I can then left click this box, and if I press N, you can see this menu on the side open. And in Node, where it says label, I can just type in the word sky. And now that's nice and organized. Zooming into my texture here, I'm just going to press X to remove this texture, and I'm going to press open again. And then I'm just going to choose my square tree texture here, and I'm going to press open image. Now, immediately we have a little bit of a problem. How are we going to combine these two things together? Well, actually, thankfully, it's quite simple since we've got a nice transparent texture. All I need to do is press Shift A, and then in converter, I'm going to choose mix. Right now, you can see we've got a blue node here, and we just need to change it from float to color. That's going to allow us to mix in two textures together. I'm going to plug my color into A of the tree and the color of the sky into B. I can then plug my result into the base color. Right now you can see our tree has been added, but we have a little bit of issue. It's kind of blending in with our sky. And you can see if I change this factor to 0, we've now got just the tree. And if I change it to 1, we've now just got the sky. If I plug my alpha socket into the surface just to preview it, you don't have to follow along with this. You can see that the tree here is white and the transparent area is black. This is very useful as this, what we call an alpha mask, will allow us to tell us which areas to make just the tree and which areas to make the sky by plugging it into this factor. When this is set to 0, it becomes the tree, and if the factor is set to 1, it becomes the sky. Remembering that black and white values actually represent a value between 0 and 1. White will represent the number 1 and black will represent the number 0. So if I plug my alpha into the factor now, then we need to think about which area will be sky and which area will be tree. And I'll plug my BSDF back into surface, and yeah, you can now see it's actually gone the wrong way around. We now have a mask which is just showing the sky in the tree area and just the transparent area of the tree and the sky area. To fix this, all we need to do is swap the A and B sockets. Now I've done that, you can see we've got our tree and sky working properly. Although to be honest, our tree is a little bit too big. That's because when we duplicated these nodes, all these settings were duplicated too. So I'm just going to reset everything. I've set my scale to 1, and I'm going to set my location to 0. You'll notice though, as we move, we can see a repeat of our tree, which we don't want. To get rid of this, here in the texture settings, there's an option called repeat. And we're just going to change that to clip. And that's just going to make it so it's just the one texture. Already you can see we've got quite a bit of depth to our tree. But we want to bring it a little bit closer. One handy way we can adjust the distance, if you like, of our tree is using another vector mask. So to do that, all I need to do is duplicate my subtract node by pressing Shift D, and I'm just going to plug that in between the incoming and the subtract. Then I'm going to change it from subtract to multiply. Right now, the multiply is set to 0, so you can see that our tree is completely still. This is because when you multiply any number by 0, it becomes 0. So it's essentially neutralizing this incoming vector. So that can be a good way to turn it off. If I set this number to 1, it's now going to go back as if we haven't made any change. Notice how it's now how it was before. If I increase this number, you can notice we can push the tree further or higher into the sky. I only want it to be a little bit into the ground, so I'm going to set it to 0.05. To do that, I'll just left click, quickly drag down and type in the number 0.05. Now you can see when we move, our tree moves a little bit. I might actually make it a little bit bigger by changing it to 0.1. There, that looks a little bit more interesting. Next up, I might adjust my tree a little bit. So I'm just going to change its location by changing it on the Y axis on location. You'll notice if I increase this number here, pushes it down a little bit, which means we can't see the end of the trunk, which actually looks a little bit nicer. One last thing I'd like to cover is sometimes you might encounter some kind of strange rotating issue when you're using the multiply to move our tree up and down. If such a case were to arise, I recommend switching from UV to generated if we're using a simple object like a plane like this. So I'll plug my generated vector. You can see right now nothing changes, but if you're having issues with the multiply, this is something you can try. The reason why generated seems to work more consistently is if I turn on my sphere here, I'm just going to left click it and press G and X to move it along. Right now it's just using a UV coordinate, but if I change it to generated here, you can see that the texture is kind of stretched in the middle here, and that's because it's just being projected up and down like this across this Z axis. And that's just a good way you can kind of counter any strange issues when you're trying to move your tree. This is usually caused by some kind of UV related issue. I'm not sure what specifically causes it, but I've just encountered it a few times while experimenting with parallax occlusion mapping. So it's something to keep in mind for this more simple example. For now though, I'll just plug my UV back into here since it's working just fine. And that pretty much covers everything. If you do want to learn more about vectors and textures in general, I highly recommend checking out my free course on texturing basics, which will include that vector video I mentioned earlier. Apart from that though, I'd like to thank you all so much for watching, and I'll see you all in the next video. Take care.